When every knee bows before your name, but we will not wait until it does, for here and now shall your kingdom reign. Will you reign? You reign. Will we sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah? We sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think of God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross
shall come with shout of acclamation and lead me home. What joy shall fill my heart?
Then I shall bow with humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great. victory.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us this morning on this wonderful day that we have that the Lord has made. And as we begin this morning, I just want to ask you if you would please would be in prayer for the Dillard family today. Let's keep them in our prayers if you would please this morning. But as we start in the Sunday school lesson, we're going to be looking at everlasting judgment or everlasting joy. When I get talking about the everlasting joy, last night I was sitting there studying and I got on the everlasting joy and I almost had church up in my living room when I got to thinking about the everlasting joy of God that we have, that we can have even right now, but that we will definitely have when we go to heaven. But God's judgment awaits all who rebel, but the redeemed of the Lord will experience everlasting joy. Hebrews 9:27 says, "And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment." This year alone, we've seen a lot of people that have passed away from this corona. We've seen a lot of people that have, I don't know, to me it seems like it's been a great exodus of people that have passed away this year.
I know that I have lost,
altogether, I have lost five people to the coronavirus, and then I've lost altogether in the last 4 months, I have lost a total of seven people.
We're going to be looking at everlasting judgment.
Just in that short amount of time, I never remember in my childhood, you know, Mama always said it comes in threes, but I've never seen it come the way that it has come this time,
thinking about the everlasting joy
and this year alone.
That we have,
but I think of the ones that have went on, and thankfully I can say that I know the ones that have went on are definitely sitting with the Father, are definitely worshiping the Father. And just as this scripture says, some people say that when we die, we stay in the grave. But the scripture says that it's just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment. Immediately, you will be standing before the Father, and immediately you will either be told, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," or either you will be told, "Depart from me, for I know you not." I don't know about you, but I want to be told, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Amen. But God's hatred for sin compels him to act with justice and to carry out the penalty that sin exacts. If the future is bleak for the ones that refuse salvation, how well do we all know it's bright for the believers? It's bleak for the ones that refuse, but it's bright for the believers. But for those who trust in the atoning work of Christ, there awaits life more abundant and blessed than they have ever known.
And this year
in 1 John 3:2, we have an example of what that time will be like. And John writes, "Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is." That old song comes to my mind, "Oh, I want to see him." I want to see, cannot wait for the day that I can lay my eyes upon the Savior. But believers will enjoy a place that the Lord has prepared for us. The most beautiful thing that I think about in this afterlife is that we will be able to spend eternity with Jesus. We may not know all the types of services that's going to be rendered in heaven, but we do know that it's going to be perfect. We do know that it's going to be an activity that each and every one of us is suited for each and every one of our lives. All I know is when I get to heaven, the only thing I want to do is worship at Jesus' feet. All I know when I get to heaven is I want, if I have a crown, I want to take and I want to throw it at Jesus' feet and worship Jesus. Amen. But it has often been said that heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. And I don't know about you, but I want to be that prepared people. Amen. Boy, that was almost like talking about Peter Piper. But today we're going to be looking in Isaiah 34 and 35. And 34 pertains to the Great Tribulation, while chapter 35 pertains to the coming millennium. And both these chapters are a prophetic message to us. And one is a vengeance against the enemies of God's people, and the other is a blessing on God's people after execution of judgment on the unrighteous. We're coming to a time that it's going to be of terrible desolation. It's going to be a time where all of the heavens, all of the host of heavens, everyone will be included in this time. We think that right now is bad because of COVID, but I'm going to tell you, we haven't seen anything yet. We think that right now is bad with tribulation and trials. We haven't seen anything yet. But I'm glad that because of God's grace, why we are here right now, that right now I don't have to worry about it. I'm glad that because of God's grace, that when that trumpet sounds and I'm caught up in the air in the rapture, Sister Francis, that I don't have to worry about what's going on here on earth. That I don't have to worry about the desolation and all that's going here on earth. And if you think that this year has been so hard, just wait. If you don't make the rapture, just wait. That gives me chills to say if you don't make the rapture. I don't want to be part of the ones, because I'm going to tell you, if you could not make it now while you have God's grace and while you have God's mercy, then what makes you think you can make it after the rapture takes place? There will be ones that will, but I don't want to be part of those. I don't want to be in that remnant, so to speak. But it will be a time, it will be a nightmare. And I want to look at Isaiah 34, and I want to talk about this morning in verses 1 and 2 about the fury of the Lord. It says, "Draw near, O nations, to hear and give attention, O peoples. Let the earth hear and all that fills it, the world and all that comes from it. For the Lord is enraged against all the nations and furious against all their host. He has devoted them to destruction, has given them over for slaughter." In this prophecy, as throughout the Bible, the evening of judgment precedes the morning of blessings. Joy comes in the morning after the weeping is done. Amen. But man in his energies has to be judged and has to be broken before the kingdom of God can even be established. And verse 2 speaks of the nations and the armies that will be gathered at Jerusalem in order to destroy the city of Jerusalem and to annihilate the Jews. And it's telling us that the Lord is going to meet them with his fury. Looking on at verse 3, "Their slain shall be cast out, and the stench of their corpses shall rise. The mountains shall flow with their blood." Now I know this seems like it might be a little bit of a rated R version, but this is speaking of the entirety of the army of the Antichrist and how they will be destroyed according to the word of God, except with the exception of 1:6 will be destroyed on this day. The dead is going to lie unburied in the fields and become food for the birds and for the beast. I don't even want to imagine walking through the field and seeing bodies just piled up so high. War has not even touched of what this day will be like, because the blood will be so strong that it will literally run down the mountainside and it will cause the soil of the mountains to depart from the side of the mountain and run down. I don't want to see that day. I don't know about you, but I don't want to see that day. Continuing on, "All the host of heaven shall rot away, and the skies roll up like a scroll. All their host shall fall as leaves from the vine, like leaves falling from the fig tree." This right here is talking about the Great Tribulation, which is going to last for 7 years. And during this time, the host of heavens, which it includes the stars and the planets, it's going to be greatly affected. The heavens is going to literally be rolled up like a scroll, and all the stars is going to fall from the sky. I don't know about you, but when I see a shooting star go across the sky, I just get chills. I've heard people say that when you see a star going across the sky, it's an angel has lost his wings. I don't like that one. Then I've heard where as the star goes across the sky, you can make a wish and it will come true. I like that one better. But I'm going to tell you something. I don't have to make a wish on a star. There is one person that I can pray to. Amen? There's one person that I can depend on. But if we look here, because of this saying that the stars are going to fall and it's going to be like leaves and fruit falling from a fig tree. We look in Revelation 6, verses 12 through 14. And it says, when he opened the sixth seal, I looked. And behold, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth. The full moon became like blood. And the stars of the sky fell to the earth as the fig tree sheds its winter fruit when shaken by a gale. The sky vanished like a scroll that is being rolled up. And every mountain and island was removed from its place. It's just confirming what Isaiah has told us in chapter 34. But if we look on in verse 5, it says, for my sword has drunk its fill in the heavens. Behold, it descends for judgment upon Edom. In other words, this is saying anyone who is opposed to Zion, they are going to see judgment. Upon the people I have devoted to destruction. The Lord has a sword. It is sated with blood. It is gorged with fat, with the blood of lambs and goats, with the fat of the kidneys of rams. For the Lord has a sacrifice in Bozrah, a great slaughter in the land of Edom. The sacrifices here that are mentioned are because it is used as an example of the coming slaughter that is coming the day of the great tribulation. In other words, what we call the Battle of Armageddon. And at that time, the Lord is going to literally, you could say, perform a major surgery on the planet. Because for the planet to get where it needs to get, God has to literally destroy all sin. The scripture continues, verse 7, wild oxen shall fall with them and young steers with the mighty bulls. Their land shall drink its fill of blood and their soul shall be gorged with fat. In other words, here all the power of man is going to be destroyed in that day. Man will have no more power whatsoever. Jesus will have all power. 2 Peter 3 and verse 9 says, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. But the Lord's patience, it does not last forever. God's patience does not last forever, because there's coming a day that his wrath is going to fall upon those that do not believe him. And Peter continued in verses 10 and 12 of 2 Peter chapter 3. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people are you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. All sin is going to be gone. John wrote in Revelation 19, 17 through 18, then I saw an angel standing in the sun, and with a loud voice he called to all the birds that fly directly overhead, come, gather for the great supper of God, to eat the flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all men, both free and slave, both small and great. Dear Lord, what a time that's going to be. I want to make the rapture. I don't want to see that. There's, as I was reading that, of course, that old Alfred Hitchcock movie come to me, Brother Mike, of called The Birds. I don't want to see that. I mean, I couldn't even watch that movie, let alone read this Bible scripture and not think of that movie, because this is what's going to happen if you don't know God. Because of the sin that is in your life, God has to wipe it out. For his kingdom to come down, all sin has to be gone. But why don't we hear this anymore? Why don't we hear about the divine judgment anymore when preachers get up to preach? It's because preachers are scared that they're going to offend someone, or they're going to come across, I'm scaring them. I'm going to tell you, I would rather scare you into hell than watch you go to hell. scare you out of hell. Let me take that back. I'd rather scare you out of hell. I said that wrong. I'd rather scare you out of hell than to watch you go to hell. But there's a lot of Christians, preachers nowadays, that don't even speak of things like this because they don't want to offend anyone. But I'm glad that here at Coosa Valley, we want to make sure that your soul's taken care of. We want to make sure that we tell you what the Lord has told us to tell you. Amen. As we look on at Isaiah chapter 34, verses 8 through 10, it says, "For the Lord has a day of vengeance, a year of recompense for the cause of Zion, and the streams of Edom shall be turned into pitch and her soil into sulfur. Her land shall become burning pitch. Night and day it shall not be quenched. Its smoke shall go up forever. From generation to generation it shall lie waste. None shall pass through it forever and ever." God's actions will not be vindictive, but will show justice that is tempered with mercy. This is going to be a time of blessing for the righteous, and it's going to be a time of punishment for the wicked. In a later passage, Isaiah wrote in chapter 66 in verses 14 through 15, "You shall see, and your heart shall rejoice. Your bones shall flourish like the grass, and the hand of the Lord shall be known to his servants. And he shall show his indignation against his enemies. For behold, the Lord will come in fire, and his chariots like the whirlwind, to render his anger in fury, and his rebuke with flames of fire." If we look on in Isaiah chapter 34, verses 11 through 17, it says, "But the hawk and the porcupine shall possess it. The owl and the raven shall dwell in it. He shall stretch the line of confusion over it, in the plumb line of emptiness. Its nobles, there is no one there to call it a kingdom, and all its princes shall be nothing. Thorns shall grow over its strongholds, nettles and thistles in its fortresses. It shall be the hunt of jackals, an abode for ostriches, and wild animals shall meet with hyenas. The wild goat shall cry to his fellow. Indeed, there the night bird settles and finds for her young in her shadow. Indeed, there the hawks are gathered, each one with her mate. Seek and read from the book of the Lord. Not one of these shall be missing. None shall be without her mate. For the mouth of the Lord has commanded, and his spirit has gathered them. He has cast the lot for them. His hand has portioned it out to them with the line. They shall possess it forever. From generation to generation they shall dwell in it." The Lord has given here a clear warning about the consequences of living a sinful life. He's not going to fail to exercise the judgment upon those that who persist to live in sin. And Isaiah unhastingly speaks of those are going to suffer and the death, and declares that justice is going to be rained upon the ones that do not follow God. When people love this world too much, it leads to ruin. It leads to defilement by their sin. You know, I say that and it reminds me of old song. "I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame.
I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be a king of a vast domain or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I don't know about you, but I'd rather have Jesus. I don't know about you, but I'd rather have Jesus than have riches. I'd rather have Jesus than have fame. I was 16 years old, and I sung at a friend's wedding. And there was this lady here that was from Tennessee. And after the wedding, she come running up to me and she said, I'm a songwriter. And I want you to go to Tennessee. I have a producer that I want you to meet. And I want you to sing the songs that I write. I said, what kind of songs do you write? Country music, of course. I said, no, thank you. I turned around and I walked off. Wait a minute. What do you mean, no thank you? I said, I'm called into the ministry. Oh. Are you sure? Because there can be a lot of money. With my songs and your voice and the producer I've got, there'd be a lot of money. I said, no, because I have better riches in Christ. Amen? We have more riches in Christ. It might not seem. I've heard people say before, well, I just don't understand it. I'm living for God. I'm doing what I can do. But it seems like just what I need is not here. I'm going to tell you, that's what Satan wants to do. If you're a threat to God, what better way than him to keep away what your riches are? What better way than him to keep away what God has promised you? And we have to stand on it. We have to stand that we are the redeemed of the Lord. We have to stand on that we are a whosoever in the Lord. Amen? And we see here that we have looked at the sorrow and we have looked at the pain and we have looked at the heartache and we have looked at the destruction that was in chapter 34. But then as we look on into chapter 35, we will see what a heart and a life yielded to God can bring. I want to look at verses 1 through 4. It says, the wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom like the crocus. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who have an anxious heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance. With the recompense of God, he will come and save you. What does this portray of God's working say to us? It says that believers are called on to encourage the ones that are depressed. That's the feeble hands that it was talking about. The terrified, that's the weak knees, and the fearful. It is given to us words of encouragement. It is given to us that do not faint. Hold on. Just keep going on because God is going to fight your battle. Praise your mighty name, Jesus. When the Lord told me to sing that song this morning, I thought, God, that's crazy. I sung last week and somebody made a statement, said, yes, she taught Sunday school and she even sung a song. But God was telling me to do it again today. And I was like, Lord, they're going to call me the singing teacher. But he said, I told you to sing it. It wasn't a course in the Sunday school book. It wasn't in the lesson. But don't you know that we've got a promise that God says, I will come and save you. I will be there. I will take you through. And when it seems like that you're walking all by yourself and you look behind in the sand and there ain't but one footsteps, it's because God is carrying you through that time. It's because God has got you in his arms and he's right there taking care of you. He's telling you that every opposition situation that arises, be assured, because he will come and he will save you. The sentence that says he will come and save you, it's actually saying he himself will come to save you. It is a time that no one will be alone. It is a time that we will see finally face to face Christ in all his glory. It is a time that we will see God standing before us in all of his glory, because he is a holy God. And he says, I will come and save you. I'm not going to leave you alone, but I'm going to come and save you. Kaylin, this week in Bible, was studying about what Christ, his promise was after he arose from the dead. And she said, Mama, wasn't it that God was going to, that Jesus was going to send a comforter once he went on? I said, yes, it was. Well, she had to write a little essay on it. And I read that essay. And as I read that essay, I got to thinking, you know, we look at what is to come. We look at the future of what is to come, and if we do not have the hope of that we know Christ is our personal Savior, then we are going to end up in hell. I'm sorry to tell you, but if you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, you're going to be the ones that is going to be judged in chapter 34. But if you know Christ and you live for Christ, then you'll be part of the ones, the remnant in chapter 35, that is going to see the glory of God. You're going to be the ones that is going to be safe. And you might say, well, that's when the rapture takes place. What's going to help me now? Well, I'm going to tell you, Paul wrote in Romans 16 and verse 20, the God of peace will soon crush Satan under your feet. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Satan is under your feet, because when Christ arose, he got the keys to death, hell, and the grave, and he gave us the authority over Satan, and he gave us the authority that we can walk on top of his head. But it's our fault when we let him walk behind us. It's our fault when we let him sit right here on our shoulder. Instead of letting him walk behind us, it's time we kick him away. It's time we literally get rid of him. Or it's time we just take him and blow him off of our shoulder and get rid of him. Give him the corona blow on him. But it's time. There's another song that I'm reminded of. I command you, Satan, in the name of the Lord, to take up your weapons and flee, for the Lord has given me authority to walk all over thee. I want to walk on him this morning. Amen. I want to walk on him, even though we're coming and we're celebrating Christmas and we might sing just a few Christmas carols. There's still the anointing in the Christmas carols. Why? Because it's talking about the birth of Christ. So this morning, even if we do, I don't even know for sure what all they've got lined up in singing, but even if they do sing Christmas carols, don't forget, even in Christmas carols, you can praise and worship him. Don't forget, in Christmas carols, you can sing praises unto God, because it says, I will worship you. Amen. I will praise you. You came to this earth for me, so what better can I do but to praise you? Looking on at Isaiah 35, verses 5 through 7, it says, then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap like a deer, and the tongue of the mute sing for joy. For waters break forth in the wilderness, and stream in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. In the haunt of jackals, where they lie down, the grass shall become reeds and rushes. During Christ's millennial reign, the changes that's going to take place during this time is not limited to just human beings, but the land is also going to be blessed. There's going to be streams that flow out of the desert. You know, you walk through the desert, and if you've been there for a long time, I'm sure you've seen on movies, they walk through the desert, they're hot, and they're just barely making it across, and they look up, and they see water, and they take off running, but then when they get to the water, it's not there anymore. And that's called a mirage. But there's going to be day that the land is going to be so blessed that that water is going to come up out of the desert. God will take care of his people. Looking at verse 8, it says, and a highway shall be there. Hold on just a second. screen just went crazy on me. And a highway shall be there, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it. It shall belong to those who walk on the way. Even if they are fools, they shall not go astray. It is proclaimed by the Holy Spirit that the way is holiness. Holiness characterizes all that God is and God does. Verse 9, no lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come upon it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. The truth that Satan as a roaring lion shall not have access to the way of the holiness. The demon spirits, which is the ravenous beast that it's talking about, shall not be found there. Therefore, the victory for every true child of God earnestly desires is found in the way of the holiness. And it is time, if we look on at verse 10, it says, and the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain gladness and joy, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. The sounds that will be heard as believer follow the way of holiness will be songs of thanksgiving. The joy and the happiness that believers experience when they receive Christ into their hearts will continue for eternity. Holiness is not a mystic sci-fi mumbo jumbo. It is thinking as God thinks and willing as God wills. One of my favorite sayings, I said it when I had my youth groups, and they ended up making a bracelet over it. It's, you have to walk the walk and talk the talk. If you don't walk that walk and you don't talk that talk, you're not living a life of holiness. You have to walk the walk of being holy. And as I come to that section of this Sunday school lesson, I was reminded in Isaiah 6, it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two, he covered his face, and with two, he covered his feet, and with two, he flew. And one called to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. I have read that scripture. I have preached on that scripture. But when I read this scripture last night, I immediately saw something for the first time that I've never really took time to talk about. But it says here that the seraphim literally covered their eyes, that he literally covered his face. He literally covered his feet. And God is telling us right here that his glory is so strong that even these sinless seraphims had to cover themselves because of the glory of God. And Isaiah standing there, he was literally hopeless because he was a man of sin. And he stood in the glory of God. And he didn't know what he was going to do next. But the angels stood in the glory of God, covering themselves and saying, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. You may say, well, what does that mean? Holy means he is a God of integrity. He is a God that cannot lie. He is a God that will take care of us. He is a God that all his promises are yes and amen. He is a God that you may say, well, he's promised me so much and I haven't seen it yet. But he's a God that you can stand on the fact that he is holy. Even though you might not have seen it, you can still stand on the fact is he is holy. And God, you promised me and I know that it's coming. God, you said it would be here and I know it's going to happen. And you might say, well, what do I do? How do I get holy? 1 Peter 1:16 says, you shall be holy for I am holy. So if you ask God into your heart, if you live with God in your heart, then therefore you will be holy. Because when God is, sin cannot be. Amen. So we are to be like him and to be holy and walk in the way of holiness. Will you be among those who will face the judgment of God at the end of this life? Or will you be an overcomer? by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. There is victory in Jesus. There is also an eternity to enjoy the blessings of the Lord. It shouldn't be a difficult decision, but the choice is yours today. The choice is yours whether you're going to be part of the remnant in chapter 34 that's going to face judgment, or whether you're going to be part of the remnant that is in chapter 35 and is going to see the glory and the blessings of God. I want to be part of chapter 35. I want to be part of the ones that see the blessings of God. I want to make sure that I live a holy life. But even though I live a holy life, it will do me no good if I just live it. I need to live it and I need to share it. Because if I share it, then those around me will live a holy life as well. If I share it and let them see what God has done in me and through me, then they will want to live that holy life as well. On the way to church this morning, I have no idea what happened, except that maybe Satan was just doing everything in his power to get me out of the anointing, so to speak. We were on our way to church, and I was getting in the turning lane, and this truck decided to just cut me right off and get over in front of me. Well, that's okay, you know. So we're in the turning lane, coming up on the road, and he just stops dead still in front of me. Well, I stop. What else am I going to do? Run in the back of him. Oh, I stop. Well, then he slowly creeps off, and as he slowly creeps off, he takes and puts his hand out the window, and he doesn't wave. Let's just put it that way. What I did to that man, I have no idea. I'm not the one that cut him off. He cut me off. And, of course, you ask Kaylin. I'm going to just go ahead and tell you, sometimes I get a little aggravated at them people that drive and tell them they need Jesus. But this morning when I saw him do that, there was a peace that come over me, and I started praying for him. I'm not trying to tell you I'm holier than thou, but I'm trying to tell you that when things come up, it's not always that there's an intent in it of that person. But you might not know what that person is going through. You might not know what just happened an hour ahead of time that unfortunately you're the one he's taking it out on. You might not know what is going on in their life. And I wanted to literally pull in and tell him God loves him and Merry Christmas. If Kaylin hadn't been with me, I probably would have. But when people act like that, you never know what they will say. You never know what they will say. But where I could have allowed the flesh to get angry, where I could have allowed the flesh to get very upset and tell him he's a jerk and, you know, he needs Jesus, that does me no good, because I need Jesus if I say that about him. So what better thing to do than to sit there and to pray for him, because I don't know what's going on in that man's life. And that's just like the scripture tells us, we are to be holy for he is holy. And when the devil rises up his head, we can stomp on that head. Amen? Again, I'm done very early. I can't help it. I get started and I just go through it. I get started and I go through it. But God is good. Amen? And we are to be holy, for God is holy. Amen? Let's just stand and let's pray this morning here in the sanctuary and on live feed. As we spoke about the judgment in chapter 34, and then we talk about the blessings in chapter 35, I'm going to tell you this morning that Christ loves you. He died for you. And if you need to know him as your personal Savior, call or text in to us. Let's just have a word of prayer, and remember as we pray, and let's remember the Dillard family. Father, as we come to you right now, Lord, we thank you for this day that you have given us. God, I just ask you right now that your blessings would be upon us. God, the blessings that we read in chapter 35, God, we can see them now. And God, I just ask you right now that your blessings come down upon us today. Lord, I just ask that you would be with the Dillard family on this day of sorrow for the human, but God, a day of shouting that she is coming home to see you. And Lord, I thank you that she knew you as her personal Savior, and God, that she's sitting with you right now. God, I just ask you that you would anoint the singers this morning. God, I just ask that you would anoint these young people. God, that it's not just something they're doing to be up in front of somebody, but it's they're doing it to give you praise and to give you glory and to give you honor. And God, I ask you right now that you would anoint Pastor in a way like you've never anointed him before. God, I ask them right now, Lord, that you would set him on fire from the top of his head to the sole of his feet, that as he brings forth the message, God, that we'll know it directly comes from the throne room of God. God, so what if he doesn't go on his outline? Hallelujah. But God, that an anointing comes so strong upon him that no one is able to stand within this church, because the glory of God is so strong. That holiness that the angels saw in Isaiah, let that glory come in this sanctuary today. Let us see you high and lifted up and your train filling the temple. And Lord, we give you all the glory and all the praise and all the honor that you so deserve. In Jesus' name, and everyone says, amen.